Thanks to the World Affairs Council. And Stephen, thank you so much for being with us this evening. Stephen is a guest scholar at the Brookings Institution and a managing director of the consultancy Koltai & Company. And as he was just sharing with me before, a very successful entrepreneur, particularly in the telecommunications industry. And as we heard, notably served in Secretary Hillary Clinton's State Department. And I think the reason for our visit today in particular is attached to the publishing of his current book, Peace Through Entrepreneurship, which builds a case for renewed emphasis on entrepreneurship in our foreign policy. So please join me in welcoming our guest. What we want to talk about this evening is, I think, a little bit about what the roots are, I think, of the problems that the book prescribes solutions to, how joblessness is part of the problem driving the security challenges in the world, how entrepreneurship and the fostering of opportunity is potentially one of the most valuable tools in our toolkit to address that, and what some of the challenges, risks, and opportunities are in applying those tools. So thank you so much for being here. I think it's of course very interesting and appropriate that we're having this conversation in San Francisco. Stephen shared with me that he was at Google this morning, and I find that the topic of your book and your thinking to be very provocative, particularly sort of some question that occurred to me is, how can we use what's perhaps one of this country's most powerful core competencies, which is entrepreneurship, job creation, business creation, and use that as a tool in our toolkit to advance our interests and protect our security. So I'm really delighted that you're here. So tell us a little bit more about let's start with this, just tell us a little background, tell us about your work. And tie it a little bit to why you see that this topic is so important today.
Well, thank you. It's great to be here. I, you know, come to this topic late in life. I spent 30 years in the private sector, and while I was always interested in foreign affairs, and I, you know, went to graduate school in international affairs, I started doing this work basically after I retired. And moved from LA, which is my hometown, to Maine. And I come to this for a very personal reason, which is that I am the child of survivors of the Holocaust. I was born in Budapest in 1954. And we came to the US when I was two in 1956. So I'm one of those awful migrants that we need to keep out, which probably two-thirds of the room are also. And so I have a very personal, visceral connection to what happens when things go really badly wrong, when the political system really collapses, and how awful that can be. And in the course of my life and work, I have sort of come to the view that there's one common explanation for why this happens. And that is joblessness. And that the single biggest correlative factor to political unrest, violence, and the breakdown of civil society is joblessness. In the book, I talk about the fact that, you know, Germany in 1932 had a 24% jobless rate. The Arab world today, and for the last more than decade, has had the largest youth unemployment rate of any region in the world. And so from my standpoint, there's a direct correlation between joblessness and violence and the breakdown of civil society. And unlike other things that affect, you know, politics, you know, centuries-old animosities, religious strife, territorial battles, battles over resources. There are things that, you know, just are impossible to solve, or at least very difficult to solve. One of the few things that actually is solvable is job creation. We know how to create more jobs. And we in America particularly know how to do that because we are, this whole economy was built by entrepreneurs. particularly so in this city. It was a great frustration to me that this really important issue was never part of American foreign policy. So in June of 2009, President Obama gave a speech at Cairo University, and he talked about using entrepreneurship, in my words, not his, in the service of foreign policy for the first time that any American president has ever done so. And I was sitting in my house in Maine, and I thought that was incredibly cool. And I ended up coming to Washington and initially working for free as a volunteer to try and create the program that would implement the words, which became the Global Entrepreneurship Program at the State Department. And I started it before the Arab Spring, and it was focused on job creation in Muslim-majority countries. We had three major countries, Egypt, Indonesia, and Turkey in that order, and five secondary countries, Lebanon, Jordan, Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco. And so, you know, this nice Jewish boy from LA spent the next 2.5 years exclusively traveling to Muslim countries and trying to promote entrepreneurship. And that's sort of how this journey began. Secretary Clinton became enormously supportive, particularly after the Arab Spring started and Tahrir Square happened and Tunisia happened, and I had the privilege of traveling with her several times on to those places. And so the book grew from that experience originally.
Yeah. If you look at our mechanisms of foreign policy and foreign assistance, you know, how good are we at this? You know, what gives you confidence that our government or any government can really expend its resources effectively to create jobs? It's hard enough to do it here. You'd think it would be harder to do it in other places.
Well, you know, this becomes a question of relative degrees.
Yeah.
In the book, I talk a lot about not only the importance of government, but the indispensable role of government. Yeah. You know, if you look, and I have several case studies in the book, the U.S., Israel, Chile, Rwanda, there's not a single example, starting most importantly in the United States, yeah, where government did not play the leading role, yeah, actually, yeah, in innovation, right? We wouldn't have an internet without DARPA. Yeah. And the same is true in almost every aspect of you know, a high IP, high intellectual property creation. So government investment is critical from that standpoint. But beyond that, there's the enabling environment, as it's, yeah, called in government circles.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, you know, government is not a nice to have, it's a must have.
Yeah.
By the same token, the book talks about the fact that, you know, we've spent $4 trillion in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan since the beginning of the Bush wars. We have lost 60,000 American lives, 250,000 allied military lives, and we have about 7 million refugees, of which more than 1 million are in Europe today, for $4 trillion. The youth unemployment rate in those three countries, to the extent that we can measure it, because there is no functioning government that controls any of those three countries. Oh. But the best data we have is that the youth unemployment rate is somewhere between 1.25 and 1.5 times greater than it was when we got there. So my argument is, what we've been doing isn't working all that well. Maybe if we took a tiny portion of that money and invested it in job creation, we might have had a different result. And certainly the data show a strong correlation between violence and unemployment rates, particularly youth unemployment rates. Yeah. So, you know, for me, it's not a question of, is government perfect at doing this? Yeah. For me, the issue is government's primary responsibility is security. That's the first job of the US government as defined in the Constitution, providing for the common defense. If you believe, as I do, that the greatest threats to security come from non-state actors today, from terrorism, and if you believe that that is primarily fueled by the desperation of jobless people, then some of the small portion of the $600 billion a year that we spend on defense, I believe we ought to spend on job creation through entrepreneurship.
So let's take that gram of hope and inspiration and talk more. Let's take that to talking about specific examples, of which there's a number in your book. But in particularly, I think, as we think about the places where our security is at greatest risk, share some examples that that would be an analog for those places, I suppose, where policies of the U.S. government or efforts of the U.S. government were powerful in helping drive job creation in other places in ways that serve the interests of those countries and ours.
Right. Well, there are a couple of examples. The most immediate example and the most recent is in Colombia. Yeah. Everyone is probably aware that, you know, this terrible civil war that has claimed, you know, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of lives over the last 30 years, seems to have come to an end as FARC has made peace with the government. So Colombia already had started with significant funding from the U.S. government, by the way, to develop an entrepreneurship center in Medellin, Colombia, and with some pretty amazing results. I mean, not compared to Silicon Valley, but very amazing compared to a country that was, you know, being torn apart at the seams. We have an opportunity now to expand that beyond Medellin to the rest of the country.
Yes.
So Colombia, to me, is both an example of where it's worked a little bit in the past and where there's a huge opportunity going forward. Another example I have in the book is Rwanda. So I've done a lot of research about Rwanda. Rwanda arguably was the biggest basket case country in the history of the world. Certainly in the last 100 years, after the genocide ended 22 years ago, the average age in Rwanda was 12. 70% of the men between the ages of 18 and 40 were dead. 65% of the women were HIV infected. And there were two physicians in Rwanda. Flash forward to today, Rwanda has had the single greatest increase in its per capita GNP of any country in the history of sub-Saharan Africa. It has also had the greatest increase in its World Bank Doing Business ranking of any country since the World Bank started keeping those rankings, meaning the government has worked hard to change the regulatory environment. Kigali has citywide Wi-Fi, which most American cities do not. And at the center of the government's effort was promotion of entrepreneurship, of which foreign funders, donors, particularly the United States, but also the World Bank, the European Union, and several other European countries, were major supporters. So there are examples of where this has really worked.
Yeah. So it's funny you mention it. I had the great honor and pleasure and honor of meeting President Kagame from Rwanda actually just last week, which I think raises another sort of challenge and question. I think particularly talk about some of the places where we see the greatest peril. Rwanda in particular is a country where you have a strong, capable, committed leader. People can take issue with some of the ways he goes about pursuing his policies, but he's an effective leader, and particularly he's been on balance effective at preventing corruption from getting in the way of achieving the ends that you just described. How do we go about pursuing these sort of policies in the many places where leadership is really at a deficit, you know, where leaders are purely self-interested, where they're not pursuing enabling environments and policy frameworks, where business is beholden to the people they know and so forth. Are there effective ways for the U.S. government to invest its time and treasure in those places, or are we better to steward our resources and focus them on the places where you can have partners in leadership like Kagame and Colombia and Israel and the others that you mentioned?
Well, it's a really good and complicated question. Yeah. And there are a couple of, you know, pieces to it that I talk about in my book and that, you know, my research over the last 3.5 years has uncovered. One is that probably the single biggest deterrent to successful entrepreneurship in developing countries is corruption.
Yeah, no question.
By the same token, there's a chapter in the book called A Million Reasons Entrepreneurship is Good for You, and don't worry, there's not really a million, but there are 13. And one of them is that entrepreneurs drive good governance because they need a regulatory environment that is clear. They need intellectual property protections. They need stable currencies. So they are actually an internal constituency that argues for better governance. Having said all of that, in the work that I do in the consulting firm, there's a three-step process: diagnostic, design, and implementation. And in the diagnostic phase, if we don't find a champion in government, I'm not inclined to continue working in that economy. Because my experience is that if there isn't an identified person, and it could be a lot of different things. You know, one of the million reasons entrepreneurship is good for you, for example, is that it is usually the only way up for those not born to privilege, which is very often women and girls. So sometimes it's the Minister of Women or Women's Affairs. Sometimes it's the Minister of Education. Sometimes it's the Ministry of Technology or ICT. Yeah. So it can be in different places in the government. My favorite is when it's the Prime Minister. Yeah. But if there isn't somebody, you're not likely to be successful.
I couldn't possibly agree more. It's certainly consistent with the experience that we have working in the health sector in Africa. Let's get even more specific. We're talking about investing our votes this year. For those of you who haven't noticed, we're in an election season. And we're worried about what policies and institutions in government we want to support and those we might not want to support as we're thinking about the candidates we're going to pull a lever for. Share with us a little bit more. You've gotten a little bit of an inside view to the government through the State Department in the last couple of years. Which agencies and departments in the government you think are best suited to sort of pursue these policies? And are there any specific programs? The one you cite, I'm quite familiar with the Global Entrepreneurship effort. They just had a gathering here in the Bay Area a couple of months ago.
That's right.
But you know, you have the Millennium Challenge Corporation, you have USAID, you have the State Department, right. OPIC. There's so many potential vehicles that can be drivers, enablers, or disablers of these things. Who do you really like? Which of those agencies or programs should we be doubling down on? And by the same token, as we just discussed earlier, is there anybody who you defund? What questions should we be asking our candidates?
Well, so on the first question, you know, what's broken? Everything is broken. In the book I talk about, there are 60 offices in 20 different departments in 12 federal agencies that in one way or another are involved in entrepreneurship promotion. That's ridiculous. And in many of them, like the State Department where I worked, they go out of their way not to work with each other in the best of times, which is also ridiculous. So the way we are approaching this right now is not the right way. And in the book, I talk about examples of programs that were done the right way. For example, in the State Department, there was quite a successful programming called GTIP, Global Trafficking in Persons, which was the program to fight human trafficking. Has it solved the problem? Obviously not. But it has made huge strides, and it has much better focused government resources across all agencies, including HHS and Homeland Security and ICE and the agencies that are most directly involved in that. Another one is PEPFAR. PEPFAR, for all of the things that, you know, everyone...
Describe for the audience what PEPFAR is.
It was the Bush administration initiated effort to fight AIDS, HIV/AIDS. And PEPFAR, by any measure, any objective measure, you know, has been successful and has been part of the reason why the epidemic is so much reduced. It's still huge, but it is substantially reduced, particularly in Africa. So there are examples of programs that work, but they all have a few things in common. They have central organization, which entrepreneurship does not have. They have significant funding. My program, the Global Entrepreneurship Program, which the President of the United States, the Secretary of State, the Deputy Secretary, the Undersecretary, all have boasted, has been one of the most successful things that the U.S. government has done in fighting youth unemployment in the Arab world. Never to this moment received a penny of federal funding. Never. All of the programming that I did occurred by begging, borrowing, and stealing from other offices and agencies. We never received a penny of direct funding, even when we were successful. So that needs to change. The federal government, the U.S. government I have a graph in here that talks about how much of our budget do we spend on entrepreneurship development compared to other wealthy countries. We're somewhere between 7, 8, and 9 in terms of ranking.
Yes.
We're at the same level as Australia. So Australia has 23 million people. It's an island. It's 15 hours away from anywhere in the world. And their GNP is 1/25th the size of the United States. We have the same budget as Australia. And I argue that that is out of balance.
Yeah.
The second part of your question is when we spend more money, we have to spend it better. Right now, I have the metaphor I use is that the way we spend money is by a procurement and contracting system that is totally broken. It's what I call turning a screw with a rubber screwdriver. It doesn't matter how hard you turn it, you're not going to turn the screw. And this is an enormous problem across the board in the federal government. 60% of federal programs are carried out today by contractors. Federal employees actually implement less than 40% of federal government programs. This number has been growing at a 3-5% compound annual growth rate for the last 15 years. All of the programs that I worked with are no exception. They fall in that same bailiwick. There are 52 volumes of the Federal Acquisition Regulations, FAR, that govern federal contracting. Each volume has 2,000 pages. They're phone book, tissue paper size pages. It is impossible for anyone whose primary business is not securing a federal contract to secure a federal contract. I mean, if you think filling out your tax form is hard, try applying for one of these contracts. I, who have a fair bit of experience, have been a reviewer for USAID, worked at the State Department, I don't apply for USAID contracts because I can't figure it out. So that's a problem. And unless we reform that process, we are not going to get the right people working on the right problems, which is what happened with healthcare.gov. Okay. All of us remember healthcare.gov. I wrote a blog at Brookings about it. The fact is that the lack of ability of the website to function just about torpedoed the whole program.
Yeah.
And why did that happen? Because the company who got the contract, who's, by the way, not an American company, had never programmed a website before, and being able to program a website with 20 variables was never a question that was a primary determinant in who won the contract. Yeah. Right? Any of us who are in private business would think that that's absurd, but that is how it runs. And so the program that I ran in Egypt, which resulted in the first business incubator that operated in Egypt and still operates today, Flat 6 Labs in the Zamalek neighborhood of Cairo, we had $2.3 million of funding through a contractor, and I could barely get the contractor to even answer the telephone because I was $2.3 million of $100 million that had been added on as an afterthought to a contract he already had, and he needed me like a third head. Yeah. So he wasn't that interested in helping me with my program, but that was the only vendor I had.
Assuming the process of a procurement could be drastically improved and simplified. Behind your question is sort of this question about whether USG should be contracting for these sort of programs, or should do more itself or contracting more. Do you have a strong point of view about that?
Well, no. I mean,
procurement, I think we can agree.
Reforming government procurement is way above my pay grade. My attitude is that in the area of entrepreneurship innovation, that might be a fertile area to try and do something innovative and entrepreneurial. So if we were to find a beta test site for a little tiny experiment, which, by the way, we have done in other things, like the GTIP and PEPFAR that I mentioned. MCC, the Millennium Challenge Corporation, was carved out of USAID in large measure specifically to get around some of these problems, which, by the way, are primarily congressionally ordained and not administratively, not by the executive branch. So it's not that people at USAID don't know it's broken. Everyone knows it's broken.
Yeah.
But no one can fix it because they don't have the authority to do that. So my suggestion is that in the entrepreneurship and innovation programs that I hope we will be able to offer in a future administration, one that maybe already recognizes the importance of entrepreneurship as a foreign policy tool, maybe that administration at the same time could also come up with some innovative contracting vehicles that would allow us to implement this better.
I couldn't possibly agree more. And at the same time, I have a recent experience which was disheartening around this. The nonprofit that I run has been involved in a conversation around with a new institution that was just created, a peristatal outside of USAID. I don't know if you've heard of it, called the Global Innovation Fund.
Absolutely.
Right? This is a new fund. It's a set up as a private entity whose money comes from USAID and the British equivalent called DFID. And whose purpose was to invest in entrepreneurial ideas with the potential for transformative impact in job creation, health, education, et cetera. It's relatively new, so giving them a little bit of a buy for being young. And what we've seen being directly involved in the process for bidding for their financial support is that they've created a new bureaucracy that's just as complicated, in some ways more complicated than the one that birthed them. And it raises this sort of this perennial question is when it comes to anything that we do, that we want as a society, investing in technology, as you said, building roads, providing for security, how do we invest our common good, our common resources for the greatest purpose, and how do you use government agency and versus contracting and so forth. Let me get to, before we go to questions of the audience, I have two last very specific questions for you. And again, thinking about, I sort of want it would be great to leave the audience with specifics they can take back to their legislators and to their dinner table conversations. One of these questions is about the where. We can't be everything to everybody. Where in the world do you think we should direct our efforts in this space that do you think would have the greatest effect? To push it even farther, if there are any specific policy prescriptions or any specific agencies or programs, if you could name one or two that you'd want to see better funded, better equipped, and what would they be? So sort of the where and the what, if you will.
Well, on the where, to me, it's a bit of a Venn diagram.
Yes.
So one of the circles is places that matter for the interests of the United States. Yeah. And we know what those are. And they are specific geographies. Yeah. And then the other circle is places where you have a reasonable shot of actually being successful, which comes back to the issue of, is there a champion? Is there, what is the level of corruption? All the places I work in, 36 countries, all have corruption that is unheard of from an American context, because that's what the developing world is about. But there are huge degrees. So you can go places where you can actually dodge the bullets and get something to happen, and others that where that is not the case. So to me, it's a combination of where we need it for our interests and where it's doable. Yeah. In terms of specific programs, in the work that I do, so I'm a business guy. To me, coming up with the right policy is very much like the adage in the startup world. It's 5% inspiration, 95% perspiration. Yeah. I feel the same way about this. Coming up with the right policy is 5%. So the fact that we figured, and the first half of my book is arguing for the policy. So I'm in that group, I'm at a big think tank in DC, Brookings, and that's what we do. So I make the argument for why this makes sense. To me, that is not a complicated or controversial argument. Very few people disagree with that.
Yeah.
It is the execution where the rubber meets the road. So, and we do a terrible job. And there are a whole bunch of specific recommendations I have for doing it better, including, number one, having some people work at executing these programs who've actually been entrepreneurs. It's a little self-serving, because I was one of those. And it's, I know, kind of an outrageous idea, especially in the Foreign Service, where everyone is a generalist. And, if it's Tuesday, I'm doing visas in Bogota. And if it's Thursday, I'm doing, healthcare in Kenya. Yeah. But the fact is that we in the business world know that there is such a thing as subject matter expertise, which in the State Department is a very kind of downscale, badly viewed thing. Everyone is supposed to be a generalist. You should be able to pick anyone up anywhere, anytime, put them in a totally different geography, and they should be able to function. It doesn't work like that. And in the startup world, there is such a thing as experience. And we happen to have in America, actually within 10 miles of this room, enough experience to probably run all of the programs that we could ever fund all over the world if only we could tap into that. So one of the things I think we need to do is create a bit of a Peace Corps for entrepreneurs, where we can bring some of these people, you know, we have to develop the personnel systems and so forth, but where we bring some of these people to work on these problems.
Yeah.
I couldn't agree more with this point about that you were saying earlier about the importance of the execution. I think if you look at how government works, and particularly how contracting works, programs tend to be very prescribed up front, and there's very little room to learn and adapt. And again, I contrast that to where you were sitting this morning, you know, and we're in the seat of entrepreneurship in the Bay Area. It's all about the plan B. It's rarely the plan A that works.
Absolutely.
And you have to have structures that allow for experimentation, for failure, for learning. And I think it's a big, big, hairy question: how can government get better at that? And how can it get better at designing programs and funding vehicles that not only allow it, but sort of encourage it? So I think time to open this up. We have a few questions, and I'm going to ask you to keep writing questions because we've got plenty of time. So if this has inspired you in any way, pick up a blue card, write a question down, and pass it to one of our staff. The first question is on a theme that you've touched on and that we chatted about before, which is about the refugee crisis. Obviously, front and center in world policy, front and center in the challenges being faced in Europe in particular, and in the U.S. in different ways. And so the question, there's two parts to this. So one is, you know, in places like Jordan, Turkey, and Thailand, they don't give refugees the right to work and or to self-employ. Should we be challenging that legal framework in these countries in addition to investing in entrepreneurship? And I'd add, I heard a great talk on what works and doesn't in refugees earlier this spring at Oxford. And one of the scholars in residence there was saying that, first of all, that you know, the notion that refugees are temporary is a fallacy, that the average tenure of a refugee is something like has grown to something like 25 to 28 years. So let's accept that they're actually now residents of wherever they've come to settle. And that secondly, the few successes this guy saw in these places is where the very values and the very ideas I think that you're describing have been tapped into. But so part of this is the policy question, but what else can we be doing to bring the ideas that you're talking about to bear on this significant issue?
Well, this is a subject that is near and dear to my heart for a number of reasons. Yeah. And you know, there are a couple of observations. I'll start with some of the data. The people who make it, and particularly in Europe right now, which I'm especially interested in, you know, there are about a million and a half refugees, mostly from Muslim countries, probably 30% from non-Muslim sub-Saharan Africa. But the largest numbers are from Syria, Afghanistan, and Libya. And those who have made it to camps in Germany are the creme de la creme. These are the people who were enterprise, talk about survival of the fittest. So these are the ones who made it in the raft, who carried their mom and their baby, who figured out how to get to, you know, the train station, and who are now living in a abandoned youth hostel in, you know, somewhere in the Rhineland. These are perfect people to train in entrepreneurship skills. These are people who have demonstrated, just by what they've done in the last 20 minutes, what kind of ambition and energy and stamina they have. So I am trying hard to persuade funders to fund entrepreneurship training programs in refugee camps and in displaced persons camps, both in Europe and in the Middle East.
And the part of this is part of this question is sort of a policy question: is should we be leaning on our allies to change the policy framework to allow people to make money?
Yeah, well, that's very difficult because you know they rightly say, you know, excuse me, we're Greece, right? We have a 50% unemployment rate.
Yeah.
Our country is bankrupt, and we have 45,000 Syrian refugees. You want us to also? So it's a little difficult for the United States to say, yes, you should do this. It is not, on the other hand, difficult for the United States to say, that's your decision, but we'd like to fund entrepreneurship training programs in one of the tents in the refugee camp.
Yeah.
Could we do that?
Although what good would it do if they're legally prohibited from earning an income?
Well, for one thing, number one, I'm a big believer that, you know, what's in your head you take with you wherever you go. We have every single person in this room is a refugee at some point, is an immigrant at some point. Yeah. Every single person in this room has one of these stories.
Yeah.
So as Americans, it is very much in our DNA. You know, some of us are more recent than others. You know, I came as a young child, others of us, our grandparents came. But we all did. So we understand what that means to bring it with you. So whether or not you're able to stay in Greece, whether you end up going back to Syria, whether you end up deciding to go to a third country because you're going to start a new life, whatever you learned, you take with you. And maybe you'll start that new business in that new place.
Yeah. All right, here's another question. So this is about what kinds of businesses should we be endorsing? So, you know, different businesses have different potential to create jobs.
Right.
You know, do you have any sort of point of view about this? Should we be focusing on micro businesses, social enterprises, extractive industries? Is there, you know, is there any track record we can point to in terms, again, I'm thinking about through the lens of U.S. policy, where we've been successful.
Right.
You know, what categories are driving the most job creation?
So this is super important, and it was a big question this morning in Silicon Valley.
Yes, I'm sure they had a category that they were interested in.
Tech. Right. So I'm all about three categories: no tech, low tech, and high tech. And I define an entrepreneur in the book as someone with the vision to see a new product or process and the ability to make it happen. And so I tell the story in the book about quinoa, which of course is very popular in San Francisco. So this was a $35 million business. It's now a $3 billion business. Same quinoa. The Incas have been eating it for 1,500 years. Same quinoa. Starbucks. They didn't invent coffee. They changed the process for selling coffee. Quinoa became a major business because it changed the process. So when we are myopic and think only of tech entrepreneurship, we miss this entire category of other stuff, which quite frankly tends to create more jobs than tech entrepreneurship. More people work for Starbucks in Santa Clara County than work for Google on the planet Earth. And that's just Santa Clara County. So it's very important in my view to look at both no tech, low tech, which is the adaptation of existing technology, like, for example, e-commerce or mobile apps.
Yeah.
How many e-commerce-enabled businesses could there be? It's basically an unlimited number. Is that new technology? No. But it is technology that creates in and of itself a whole bunch of new industries. So that's not to say that I don't believe in tech entrepreneurship, but I believe in all three kinds of entrepreneurship and the programs that are necessary to develop the ecosystem for those different kinds are also different. Yeah. So people who work in non-tech don't sit in front of a computer with headphones on, you know, at a desk that raises up and down in different levels and eat granola. That's what people who develop tech things do. Right? That is not what people who develop a new market for quinoa do. They look different. They do different stuff. They need different mentoring. They need different connections.
Okay.
So we have to modify our entrepreneurship support services to support those different kinds of entrepreneurs.
Yeah. Related question specifically about you know, and I'll broaden this. The question was about microfinance as a sector. And of course, I think I'd expand it to include sort of the what's come out of microfinance, which is a whole range of innovation in tech for finance, mobile money, mobile money, mobile lending, mobile marketing, and so forth. Again, examples where we've been successful at that. And how high would you put that on the list of things that we should be advocating?
Well, because I'm a kind of a business guy, I believe that you should let the market tell you rather than you tell the market. So I am less a believer in picking the sectors that should be bolstered in a particular economy than I am in listening to what the entrepreneurs in that economy think should be happening. Now, they have to be schooled. They have to understand what the range of options is. Yeah. But, you know, there is this kind of white man, we know it, you don't sort of thing, which is, we've figured out how to do this. We're going to show you how to do this. You do it a few times, then we'll leave, and you keep doing it. Yeah. My experience is that it actually isn't exactly like that. That I have learned almost as much from the entrepreneurs I've met as I've been able to teach. And in many cases, there's a lot of what we call, or what I call, south-south innovation, not north-south innovation. Yeah. So, for instance, mobile money, M-Pesa, Kenya, 40% of the market. They are light years ahead of probably where anyone in the developing world ever will be, because the banking system in Kenya never evolved, and therefore they came up with a workaround. Yeah. And that's what M-Pesa is. So, you know, are we the right people to necessarily have come in and said, no, you don't do that. What you do is you set up a branch banking system and everyone has a Wells Fargo account so you can all have credit cards that you never ordered? You know, is our way necessarily the best way to do this?
So this gets to, this is a good segue to this next question here, which is, again, it gets down to the grass tops, if you will, about what we should do, you know, how we should best invest our time and money in these places. So the audience member asked, in Colombia, when you talked about investing in entrepreneurship, what specific, you know, what were the specific programs that we did? You know, was this training? Was this foreign direct investment, venture capital? Were we using the regional development banks? And I would add to it, you know, what can you talk all about the numbers? What kind of, and you know, how many jobs can we attribute to our efforts?
Well,
if possible.
It's very hard to talk just about Colombia for me because I haven't studied it closely enough to be able to address that.
Sure.
But I can give you some numbers.
Yeah.
You know, on the range of numbers to create a job is somewhere between $700 and $1,800 per job.
Yeah. That sounds like a good ROI.
So, you know, I think so, but you know, everyone has to make their own decision. But that generally has been what the data show.
Yeah.
Obviously, non-tech, low-tech, high-tech are different numbers, but that's the range. Secondly, in the book, I talk a lot about my particular prescription for entrepreneurship development, which I call the 6+6 model, which basically is predicated on the fact that there's no single thing you can do to move the dial in an entrepreneurship ecosystem. You have to do a combination of things. So if all you do is set up a venture fund, or all you do is set up a business incubator, or all you do is have a business plan competition, any of those things individually will not work. If you do a combination of things, and I talk about this a lot, 6 categories of activity: identify, train, connect, and sustain, fund, enable public policy, and celebrate entrepreneurs, and 6 categories of organizations who are involved: corporations, foundations, universities, investors, NGOs, and government. If you do programs that knit all of those things together, you have a much greater likelihood of success. So in an ecosystem like Medellin, or others that have been successful, Monterrey, Mexico is another good example. Yeah. Amman, Jordan is a place I spent a fair bit of time and is probably the most successful ecosystem in the Arab world. Yeah. Ghana, you know, we did a, which is in the book actually, we did a whole diagnostic in Ghana of what the ecosystem looks like. What all of these places have in common is that they have some of all the things I just mentioned. They do not have just a new incubator. They do not have just a business plan competition. They have a combination of things. And what we try to do in the consulting work I do is figure out where the gaps are and then come up with programs that fill those gaps. So it's the analogy I use is like being a doctor. A good friend of mine is here who is one. A doctor. So every human being on the planet has the same anatomy, physiology, biology. And every doctor who goes to medical school studies that. And there is a medicine cabinet full of remedies, which are the choices of remedies we can use, right? However, no two people usually are ever treated in exactly the same way for exactly the same condition because there are a whole bunch of unique factors at play in that individual at this moment in time. It's the same in the work I do. The choices of tools that are available are pretty standard. The way we do the diagnostic is totally standard. Yet the plan we come up with for a particular economy is unique.
Yeah, and I think as you were saying earlier, one of the challenges is having some sort of structure around which those tool, both the diagnosis and the plan can be put together, because the way the U.S. government works doesn't tend to knit those things together.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And one of the questions that's related to this, just to give a specific example, because one of the criticisms I always get after I give these presentations is you didn't tell us about a specific program. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to tell you about a specific program. Yeah. Entrepreneurship promotion is not that expensive. Yeah. And a little bit goes a long way. So one of my the favorite things I do, there are a couple dozen programs I use in different combinations, but one of them is called Entrepreneurship Journalism Training. So the basic idea is that one of the big problems in entrepreneurship in developing countries is the culture almost always is against entrepreneurship. It is considered too risky, and you don't do it. So overcoming the cultural, it's the exact opposite of here. Here they're rock stars. There they're the sproutling growing up between the cracked pavement and the concrete through all of the broken bottles and beer cans and all of that. It's a very unsexy thing. So how do you change that? Well, the one thing that every country that I've ever worked in has is some entrepreneurs, but no one knows about them. So in entrepreneurship journalism training, we celebrate those entrepreneurs. I bring in a US journalist, either digital or print. We don't even talk to entrepreneurs, we talk to other journalists. And I have them spend 1 or 2 days in workshops training local business and economics writers how to cover startups. Here's where you find them. Here's what you asked them when you did find them. And now, each of you go out and do 5 stories. 20 people.
Yeah.
I've done it in 4 countries. Tunisia, Jordan, Indonesia, and Ghana. In every one of those cases, all of a sudden, lo and behold, they found local entrepreneurs. They started talking about them. And guess what? Those people are much more relatable than Mark Zuckerberg and Larry Page. Because they're there, and they struggled through, and they dealt with the corruption, and they, so that's an example. And that program, by the way, in each of those countries was $25,000.
I heard a great study that that was done in East Africa not too long ago. Your principle on a micro level, which is this is trying to it was a program to try to improve the effectiveness of micro entrepreneurs, and what they did was they made 1 minute videos of successful micro entrepreneurs, and they show them to other micro borrowers to inspire them about how they could run their small business just a little bit better. And just showing them the 1 minute video, an example of someone from their culture in their same circumstances, how they did better, was shown through a randomized study to improve the business results of the other entrepreneurs. I think that's a terrific idea. So here's, again, in the Bay Area is another sort of obvious question here, which is what's the role of the private sector in this? We're talking about, you know, I think the thrust of your book is about government policies and practices, but hazard a guess, a lot of people here work at companies in the Bay Area. Sort of what's the role for companies, both local, in the countries that we're talking about, and companies based here, and I'll broaden. I'll just append another question about more broadly in our from a policy point of view, is what can we be doing to promote more investment and to lower barriers for investment? Of course, this is very topical in our political discourse right now. Any thoughts on this question? Where does it? Some would argue the idea might be if this is the core competency for entrepreneurship is in the private sector,
right,
should we be using the private sector as the pointy end of the strategy?
Well, absolutely. I mean, to me, the role of government is primarily funding and regulatory reform. All of the other things, the single most important thing that I've found in my research that defines a successful versus unsuccessful entrepreneur, and by the way, this is true in the US or outside the US, it's the same thing, is mentorship. So mentorship, and I talked about this morning at Google, and I'm gonna say the same thing to you all now. For any of you who are, you know, inspired by any of this and who care and wanna think about it beyond this hour, you know, and you ask what you can do. Well, there are several things you can do. One is you can help get the word out, because we are going to have some sort of a viral campaign to get Congress to change the way this works and make a new administration give it serious attention. But on a personal level or on a company level, you know, you can mentor. You can mentor remotely. In all the programs that I do, mentorship is a key element every place I work. And it's about having a big enough network of the right people. So, you know, mentoring, including, volunteering your time either through your company, persuading your company to do this is a good thing for starters. And most companies have some sort of CSR kind of program that this would fit in. And then doing it yourself. And there are a whole host of organizations that are involved in the kind of work that I do. There's a website, Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs, ande.org, which lists about 75 or 80 entrepreneurship development organizations and that work in every aspect of this space. And my own firm is sort of like a general contractor that uses all of these. Okay. So having your company or yourself individually participate in these is actually not that hard to do.
Yeah.
Especially, by the way, for those of you who have language skills. So if you are unlike most Americans and you actually can work and speak in a foreign language, then you have huge contributions to make.
Now, what about the foreign direct investment aspect of this? So we have some pretty big companies in this in the zip codes around where we're sitting right now. And obviously, we're in a country that's one of the largest investors, the private sector's the largest investors in economies that are part of this conversation. That doesn't sound as entrepreneurial, but we're talking about potentially a lot of money. There are controversial aspects of this, of course, when you think about our trade policies that are being hotly debated. But how important, you know, and yet those policies are very powerful. They can spur economies and they can stall them. It's a bit of a hot potato, but do you want to catch it?
Well, I'll just say a little bit about it. It's a big subject, as you rightly point out. You know, so impact investing. Everybody's probably heard of impact investing.
Yeah.
Impact investing, double bottom line, it's sometimes called ESG, it's sometimes called. All of these kinds of investment funds, and there are now billions and billions of dollars of impact funds, are important and are absolutely making a difference. I have a couple of issues with impact investing. One is that 80% is in what I call the clean green space. So once you get out of clean green and you talk about things like fighting corruption, press transparency, human rights, you have a much shorter list of investment vehicles.
Yeah.
Number two is that in the sort of work that I do, entrepreneurship development, it is very difficult for a company, and there are exceptions. Yeah. Google for Entrepreneurs is one. Yeah. Cisco used to have, but no longer has a program. Ernst & Young, where you were one of the winners of the competition. The competition that you won locally exists all over the world.
Yep.
And is enormously powerful and has really made a difference in a lot of places. And I could, you know, Walmart, MasterCard Foundation. There are several companies that have identified entrepreneurship promotion. Yeah. Starbucks, Howard Schultz, that have identified entrepreneurship promotion as a key element they want to work in. But by and large, the further the time of return is removed from the time of investment, the shorter the number of people who want to participate. And that is where government has a role. Yeah. When the return on investment is 10 years out, in a world where people are looking for quarterly returns, it's very difficult for any kind of, you know, financial investor to justify to their limiteds, you know, why I'm making this 10-year out possible investment. And that's the role of government.
You know, I share a lot of your skepticism about the world of impact investing, by the way. The phrase patient capital, which is also often associated with that sector, strikes me as a good way not to make money, is to be too patient. But although I am sort of dipping my toe into it a little bit more, the Texas Pacific Group, which is a big local private equity firm, has just committed $1 billion to a new impact fund called Rise, where I'm an advisor. So, and I think, but I think the objective there is to make it a market rate of return sort of fund, which I think has the potential for being a greater magnet for this kind of investment. But I think the big political question is, should we be adopting policies that make it easier for U.S. companies to invest in these other countries, to build, dare I say, to create jobs in those places? Now, well, on the one hand, there's a lot of voters who are very unhappy about that idea. If they saw that there was a significant security advantage to it, and not just a threat to the economy, are those a set of policies, or at least an argument for a set of policies that we should be in favor of?
Well, just very briefly.
And you're not running for anything, so
no, I'm running away from something, so I'm not running for anything. The fact is that you can make money investing in developing countries. And one of the things I talk about a lot in the book are the success stories. Every one of the developing countries, especially the middle-income countries that I was working in, even the ones that have had some problems, like Turkey, still have growth rates that are two or three times the rate, the OECD rate, number one. Number two, if you look particularly at the no-tech and low-tech sector, the application, pick a name, the Uber of X, the Facebook of X, the Sprig of X, those are all exportable businesses. And in most cases, you have kind of kicked the tires and you know what works and what doesn't. So it actually is more likely that you will be successful. So imagine, one of the companies that I worked with in Indonesia is in the motorcycle, basically Uber for motorcycles, called Gojek. Okay. So this company, we took a delegation, U.S. entrepreneurship delegation there 6 years ago. They were looking for $250,000. They just got a $570 million investment from the Chinese with a $1.2 billion valuation. Yeah. Okay.
Which country, sorry?
Indonesia. Right?
Yeah.
Jakarta.
Yeah.
Right? So it's about gridlock in Jakarta. Yeah. Every single developing country capital that I have been to has gridlock.
Yeah.
They all have exactly the same problem.
Yeah.
Some places you also suffocate at the same time. Some places you get spit on at the same time. Yeah. But they all have traffic that does not move. This is an entirely transportable south-to-south business. They are going to do unbelievably well in Bangkok. They're going to do great in Dhaka. Yeah. They're going to be incredible in Lagos.
Yeah.
They're going to kill it in Cairo.
Yeah.
And they already, just in Jakarta, had a $1.7 billion valuation.
Yeah.
Are there any American investors that would like to be invested in a company like that? Probably yes.
Yeah, I think so. I could think of a few. It is interesting how some of these U.S. Innovations, in particularly in the tech space, and in which cases our companies are successful at replicating, in which cases local competitors have beat them to it. Here's a question about the when. We talked about the where and the what, and here's the when question, which is, what thoughts do you have about what's the right time to be applying these strategies, particularly when you're talking about countries that are in conflict or crisis or transition? Should we be, you know, should we be waiting until, say, you know, wars and crises of migration subside, or is that exactly the time that we should be, should we be doing this? We have, again, limited resources. You know, what's the smart play there? And I'll share one. I have to share one interesting anecdote because this reminds me of a question I heard asked to the World Economic Forum audience about 2 years ago. And the panel included the most successful entrepreneurs in Africa, including a guy named Akila Dangote, who's the most successful entrepreneur of them all. He's worth about $20 billion, or he was until the latest commodity moment. And someone asked him this question about Nigeria, which is famous for many of the challenges that you described, corruption at the top of the list, saying, when should we invest in Nigeria? And his answer was, well, if I had waited until the next administration was elected, until when I thought the political situation was stable, or until all these problems had been solved, I wouldn't be sitting on the stage today with the fortune that I have. I thought that was a real, I think, sort of put the audience quite quiet after that. But what's your, again, we have choices to make
absolutely.
In our policies. Do you have opinion about the timing question?
Well, I definitely think, and I know we're basically out of time, so yeah. Maybe this will be the last one. But I definitely think that you can't, you know, chapter three is a million reasons entrepreneurship is good for you. So I am very much an evangelist for entrepreneurship as a foreign policy tool, and I believe it's useful and important everywhere. Having said that, there are places where it's more likely to work and less likely to work. And I don't believe in spinning your wheels when it's not going to happen. There are certainly countries I refuse to work in myself. I refuse to work in places where, you know, I'm likely to get killed. I refuse to work in places where the level of corruption is so great that anything you do will be like building a sandcastle at high tide. And there are a lot of those. I refuse to work in a place where there's no champion. At the government level. But even with all of those caveats, there's a long list of incredibly interesting, exciting opportunities. And, you know, Americans especially, and it's a little, you know, we're at the World Affairs Council. So this is by definition a slightly more worldly group because you showed up. And I would imagine that everyone here has traveled. That is not necessarily true of America as a whole, but you know, we know from our own experience, our own direct experience, that there are some extraordinary opportunities in places that you never would have thought of. I certainly have found some of those. I mean, this Indonesian example that I mentioned, I mean, it never would have occurred to me. You know, Indonesia, fourth biggest country in the world, largest Muslim country in the world, 240 million people, archipelago with 10,000 islands that, you know, spread over a space the size of the United States. Basically no good universities, frankly. It never occurred to me that this was a place where you could make a lot of money.
Lo and behold.
So, major issues, lots of problems. There was a big election. The corruption issue was slightly reduced, and it's a little better, and there certainly is a champion there. So that's an example of a place where I think it's time. If we only, if all we did was work in the places where the stars are in the right place right now, and I think there are a lot of those, we would have our hands full.
Agreed. Thank you so, so much for coming to share some of your valuable time with us this evening. I think nothing could be more topical conversation. I think we'd all agree that the advances we've seen in health and development and in stability around the world have almost inevitably been accompanied or driven by advances in the economy, driven by job creation and entrepreneurs. So please join me in thanking Stephen for being here. And thanking the World Affairs Council for hosting us. And for those of you who would like to read this inspiring book, it is available here on sale. Thank you so much for coming. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.